Dave Giles.
Hello, guys. My name's Dave Giles. As your representative, I'm going to go to D.C. and undo all of the junk that this administration has done. I'm going to get with like-minded representatives and follow the Constitution of the United States. I'm a businessman. I have an MBA. I fly commercial jet airplanes and have a federal firearms license right here in Arizona. So I am business oriented. I also have a Bachelor of Science degree in electrical engineering. I have multiple technical certifications. I work for the largest oil company in the world, Saudi Aramco. I'm also a man of faith. I attend church weekly. I have a BA in theology, two Master's of Arts degrees in theology, and my doctorate is all but dissertation.
All right. Thank you very much.
And now we turn to Jerone Davison.
Well, thank you for having me. God bless you, Arizona. I've been looking forward to spending some time with you. I've been knocking on over 500 doors, passed out thousands of flyers, made many calls, hoping to speak with you. I'm a former NFL player, a pastor, an author, former running back for Arizona State Sun Devils. I'm the father of four beautiful daughters. I have one son and two grandchildren. I have served in the community for many years, served as a community leader, motivating young athletes, Little League, junior high, high school, and even college athletes to pursue education and to do their best. Many have went into the NFL, some have into the NBA. I'm also a pastor and a motivator into our community. I served the community for several years, and I would love to be your representative in Congress.
All right, thank you very much. And now it's time for Rene Lopez.
Hello, I'm Rene Lopez, a third generation Arizona native and a third generation Navy veteran. I was born and raised right here in the middle of the district, and I want to represent you in Congress. I've also started up a nonprofit that we help young women rescue from sex trafficking from all around the state. So I want to bring my life experiences as a naval officer and working the civilian side in energy and technology, along with my 8 years of coalition building on the Chandler City Council, to represent you in Washington, D.C. So over the last 2 years, we've seen the extreme power grab that the federal government has made over our lives and our businesses. And what I want to do is go represent you in Washington, D.C. to restore that power back to the states and back to the individuals where it belongs. Too many people think that other people can run their businesses. You can run your business better than government, and you can raise your kids. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, gentlemen. Let's get it started. Dave Giles, we'll start with you. What is the most important issue for this district?
Getting the economy back going again. I plan to get into Congress with like-minded representatives and get this economy going again, start building the pipeline, which was approved and paid for. We got to stop all of the executive orders that have made this country into the pits. We got to stop mask mandates. We got to stop vaccine mandates. We have government overreach. Government overreach is a problem. I support this Constitution and everything that's in it. If it's not in here, I don't support it. And the 10th Amendment says what is not in here, is specified in here, is to reserve back to the states or the people. And these executive orders are not in here to be.
All right, Jerone Davison, most important issue for this district.
Well, one of the things, good things is knocking on doors and getting a census of what the people are saying. People are concerned about parental rights. They're concerned about education. They are concerned about people teaching this sexuality to their children at young ages, and parents want to have a right and a say into the curriculum of their children. They don't want the schools dictating what the children can be taught. They want to have parental rights. Also, the moratorium, the rent moratorium is ending. Jobs are bad. COVID has caused a great divide between commerce and community. I want to heal that. I'm bringing job commerces and job fairs in here to help bring that together. So that's the thing.
In addition to that, in this Constitution, the Department of Education is not there. That needs to be reverted back to the states.
If that needs to be reverted back to the states, in your view, then what could you do in Congress if we take education out of the hands of the federal government and put it in the states' hands?
Oh, well, if the question is to me, we can vote to defund the Department of Education. And that's what we would do.
Rene Lopez, biggest issue, big issues, overriding issues in this district.
Well, again, also knocking doors and walking and talking to our constituents. I mean, it's just the same thing we see every city, and it's across the state. It's not just in our district. It's across this country. What we're paying at the gas pump, what we're scared to do and pay at the grocery store, it's affecting everybody. This is affecting all of our lives at every level. So, again, the federal government has intervened. Again, the quantitative easing needs to stop immediately. And the federal government needs to balance their budget. A lot of this extension the resources, it's insane. So the federal government needs to rein themselves in. And what that will do is contribute to the rest of the items that we have issues that we have going in. Border security is very, very much a big issue, and so is parental rights. But in the end, if people every day can barely pay their with their minimal paychecks, make their ends meet, everything else goes to the sidelines.
How much did COVID play a part in all this?
Well, so COVID played a major part in that the federal government definitely did overreach, and not just the feds. Many states, look, at the city level, we dealt with this. I fought against both state intervention and federal intervention. And we won many of those points. However, they're the ones that put us into this situation. They're the ones that took jobs away from people that wanted to work.
But you said taking away federal intervention. Federal intervention wasn't designed to take away jobs. Federal intervention was designed to save lives regarding a pandemic. Was that approach the wrong way to go?
So initially, it was not. So again, everyone remembers back the history of this, the whole 2 weeks to suppress the curve. That went out the way, what was it, 2 years now. And again, this isn't a soundbite. This is reality. I was dealing this on the front lines, talking to all of our constituents and talking to the ones that were giving us the data from the county and the state. And so once we had the plans in place, a lot of our hospitals, in order to absorb the growth, and again, the intended issues that were going to be coming with a massive pandemic that would come, once those were put in place, it was time to open back up. But everybody started manipulating data, and we can go down the rabbit hole of the data manipulation that the governments did with COVID. But after that, it was no longer serving a purpose. It became political, and that was the unfortunate part. This became a political
item. It's government overreach. Clearly, it's government overreach. I mean, to go out and say that you can have a mandate for a couple of weeks, like we said, a couple of weeks, but ended up in 2 years. This is where executive orders have gone too far. And what I want to do when I get to Washington is get with like-minded representatives to take away that Patriot Act that's put our people in prison and allow them to make executive orders. That stuff's got to go. Because our President Roosevelt can declare war, but he's not legally allowed to do that. Only Congress is. Congress makes the laws, not the president with a stroke of a pen.
I want to go back to COVID, the last question regarding this. Jerone, do you believe that the country did the wrong thing in its approach to the pandemic, considering how many lives were lost and how many lives were changed?
Well, I certainly do believe that there was government overreach, and I do believe that they did the wrong thing by shutting down the economy. Lots of people were hurt, students were hurt, families were hurt. There was a lot of emotional distress, there was a lot of economic distress, and this thing was shut down, not by the president, but it was shut down by unelected bureaucrats like Dr. Fauci. These people had more power than the president of the United States. They overstepped our reach. Now, here's the thing. No matter how good the endeavor intentions are, breaking the law is breaking the law. They broke the law by taking away our freedom to operate and freedom of speech and freedom to maneuver in this country.
But shouldn't we be listening to, COVID was a public health concern, yeah, you know, at the beginning and remains one. Shouldn't we be listening to the experts on that as opposed to, you know, with all due respect, but politicians?
Right. I mean, we do believe that they have been in this position for a long time, but they failed to not follow the science. They were telling us that they were following the science, but they were not following the science. Had they followed the science, well, then we believe that there would have been certain therapeutic cures that we could have done, and we would have saved a lot of lives by using therapeutic cures and not trying to force people to get the mandates.
Rene, you want to get in on this?
So, yeah, if I can interject, a lot of this is data manipulation, as I mentioned before, and going into the root cause and a lot of the items that we were being told regarding deaths, infection rates. There were so many nuances and details behind that data that was not being provided to the public. And this goes back to the nuances of, yes, I 100% agree that accountability lies with the leaders that are managing this crisis, the governors and the state legislatures and also the presidents. They're the ones that were sending a lot of these edicts down. Now, they're dependent. They're the ones that are listening, again, supposedly listening to their experts. But again, when I started asking deeper questions amongst both the governor and just in general about the data that was being manipulated and provided. We got a lot of feedback that this was not going to be provided and it was going to be held back because of the undesirable intention that we may be able to go back and rehash that data to see where they were wrong. So right now, again, you know, again, COVID is a mass pandemic. Okay. I completely agree that we needed to do something in response. But again, the executive orders and giving local control to cities. This is another one.
Wyoming is the same. We have to stop you right there because we got to get Mr. Giles in here. Why would presidents, governors, civic leaders, government leaders, why would all of them want so much commotion, so much distraction, so much destruction to come by quote-unquote manipulating number? Why would you want this?
They want power. They want absolute control.
It's simply a matter of power.
Absolutely. They want the power. You've got the experts. You know, one expert will say one way, another expert. And even within the experts, they change their mind on a daily basis. You can't trust them.
Well, but conditions change, you know, often as well.
Yeah, if we get all the facts out there, they're manipulating the facts out to put out the narrative that they want. They want to control the people by either by a vaccine or by making you wear a mask. You know, just, you know, arbitrarily wear a mask.
But why would you want to control people? Why would I want you to wear a mask and get a vaccine if I don't think that it's going to help control a pandemic?
Because they want power. They want absolute control
of power.
Simple matter. Because you look at it, what it was pre this administration when you were trying to get ventilators to the people and hospitals and get the people out there working and giving them the tools that they need to fight to give them ivermectin. I mean, it worked for President Trump when he had it. Get the medications to the people and stop saying that, oh, you got to wear a mask. And it goes on for 2 years. That's why I say we need to get in and limit these powers. Because when President Roosevelt declared war, which is not legal, only Congress can do it, within 1 hour, Congress declared war. So if it's that important to get done, Congress will make a law and we'll make it a law. Yeah. But to have an arbitrary stroke of the pen is ridiculous and overreach, a gross overreach, and it's got to go.
Gotcha.
Okay. Well, we know it was a power move. We had several governors, and most of them were in Democrat-ran states. You had Governor Cuomo, who manipulated the numbers in the elder care in the hospitals, and they put COVID-positive people in there, and a lot of lives were taken based on those things.
Yeah, they had a temporary hospital.
Brother Giles? We do also know that they used the auspices of COVID to manipulate voting suppressant. So they used it to do the mail-in ballots, and there were millions of mail-in ballots illegally sent out. I received several in my mail. I released several of them. And they used that to do the in-home voting instead of going to the ballot to vote.
Yeah, you've opened up another can of worms.
Well, yeah. Last point on this. I mean, again, this sounds like when you have health experts saying X and you have politicians saying Y and you're talking about manipulating numbers, do you think the voters, the Republican voters, you're Republicans, you're all running in the primary here, do you think the Republican voters in that district want to hear this message?
So I'll address it two ways. Once I address it and close out this, that I don't know about them. Again, I don't see into people's hearts. I don't know why they do the things they do. All I know is that it was a lack of leadership, because if you do dial down into some of the data and the proof and the pudding, again, all the stuff that's coming out right now, is that a lot of this, you know, whether masks were effective or not, whether the shutdowns were effective or not, again, doing blanket edicts from a federal or a state government. Wyoming is not the same as California. Eloy, Arizona is not the same as Phoenix or Tucson. So doing those kind of edicts to me is one, unreasonable and impractical, and it's a lack of leadership. Now, when we talked about this and we started down this COVID path pretty quickly, but that was never mentioned when you talked about what is important in this district. It's really about the economy. It's about border security and parental rights. Right now, again, in this district, walking around, we were walking neighborhoods, nobody was really concerned about COVID anymore, other than the federal government of paying people to stay home under the guise of COVID.
You talk about the economy, both Rene and Mr. Giles, you've mentioned that, but CD4, you know, has intel. It has, you know, it's a very strong economic sector in our state. What more needs to be done in CD4 to strengthen the economy?
Get government out of the way, first off. We got too much government telling us what to do, they're clamping us down. Like they're closing down office buildings, get them opened up. A lot of this needs to come down to the lower level of government. City, for instance, needs to be governed, but not at the federal level. We talk about at the federal level, the presidential level, it's not in here, it's an overreach. and it's myself being a representative going to D.C., we got to limit the overreach and give it back to the states and the people. If you want to wear a mask, wear a mask. If you don't, don't. It's your life that you're going to be dealing with.
Where did the federal government shut down buildings in Arizona?
Wear the masks or, you know, you get out of the buildings. They're just telling you your concentrations of people. You can't have high concentrations of people in one area. They shut down movie theaters. That's why they shut down the schools, because they had to send the kids home or wear a mask. Getting everybody out of the group area together was their goal. They want power over you.
But I believe that was done at the state level, not at the federal level. I think that gets us into a question of, you know, where do you draw the line between what you can do as a member of Congress?
Well, one of the things that was on a federal level, and that was the vaccine mandates. And that harmed a lot of jobs. You had a lot of people in our community.
You're fired if you don't take the vaccine.
Who work?
Remember that?
In the airline sector, they work in healthcare, and they were very concerned about the shot, very concerned about their own health, very concerned about what they put in their bodies. And the government was mandating this: either you get the shot or you lose your job. So that has hurt the economy in a terrible way. It has hurt the economy also psychologically. There's a lot of people psychologically not willing to go back to work because they're afraid of either the COVID or not getting the mandated shot. So it's hurt the economy in a terrible way.
Well, let's talk about something very topical, abortion, with the leaked draft of the Supreme Court opinion that came out last week. What is your position? We'll start with Rene on, should Congress pass a federal ban on abortions, or is it better to leave it to the states to do as they would?
When it comes to the Roe v. Wade, so first off, whoever leaked that, again, needs to be found and held responsible, because that violates the trust of everybody that's working for the Supreme Court and the general of the federal government. Any leak like that does need to be sought out, rooted out, and removed. When it comes to, again, Roe v. Wade, I believe it was an overreach to the beginning. It was where the Supreme Court was out of whole cloth creating law and policy where there was no federal, legislative mandate. They decided that they were going to say that the Roe v. Wade allows abortion nationwide. So, you know, where I stand on this is that repeal does need to happen. I'm very happy and pleased that they are going to be considering it. I don't know where it's going to land. It does, you know, I mean, the only draft that was provided was the counter draft. I'm wondering if there's a draft on the other side that still has not been leaked, right? Mm-hmm. Which I'm willing to bet there's one in play. But in my opinion, this again comes down to where the Supreme Court really overstepped their bounds, and they upset the balance of powers. Because if they, in this precedent, are able to set law, it makes them the most powerful branch of government, and we don't need anyone else. So having them rescind this, I think, puts it back to where legislation needs to deal with it, and if not, it goes back to the states.
Mr. Giles.
Oh, back to the states, absolutely. I'm glad that they're leaning that way now, that they're going to get it out. It's an overreach of federal government. It was an overreach, you know, decades ago.
I believe the question was, if you were in Congress, would you vote for a federal ban on abortion?
No, it's not part of the Constitution. It's not in the Constitution. I stick with this.
And Mr. Davison?
Well, I mean, I believe being an African American, I do know that there was a plan set by Margaret Sanger to use Planned Parenthood and abortions to keep the black population at a minimum. And it has worked beautifully. We only make up 12% of the population in America, and it should be far, far above that. But would I do a federal government? No, I wouldn't do that, because that's over government overreach. But I do support the fact that it's going back to the states, and hopefully the states would look at the history of this thing and look at the history of it hurting and destroying not only the fetus, but destroying the woman. The statistics tell us that the African-American women who get these abortion processes are at higher risk of breast cancer. And this is why breast cancer is higher among African-American women than any other population. So I'm totally against it.
So if abortion becomes more limited, as this draft might suggest that we're looking at...
The draft is not suggesting that. It's just saying it goes to the states. The states can make it more limited or less limited.
And so we're in a state where we already have a new law in the books that would limit it, make it a tighter restriction after 15 weeks. My question is, should anything be done on the other side of that equation for births that may happen, where in impoverished, distressed situations, to provide support for that mother and child? Are more social services needed if... if abortion is removed as an option for families?
There's people wanting to adopt babies all over the place. They can't get enough.
I don't know.
We talked to the Department of Child Safety. They got a lot of kids up for adoption that that are looking for homes.
Well, I don't believe that we should, you know, fund Planned Parenthood, because Planned Parenthood had that beginning as a racist organization. But there is good with the process there for lower income women who have health issues and health concerns. Let's keep that portion and let that be funded. But as far as the abortion goes, I think we should ban that. Any funding that goes to, whether on a federal or a state level, that goes to Planned Parenthood should be banned.
We don't need to have our federal government funding.
More services, Rene, more services this goes through?
So again, as I mentioned, I started a nonprofit. We help young women rescue from sex trafficking. And out of the sex trafficking industry comes a lot of unintended consequences, a lot of unintended births. But you're kind of putting in a couple of straw arguments and also some nuances that are not really an abortion debate. When you talk about whether services are needed at a state level for young women with children, and we have WIC, we have the SNAP programs, we have a lot of these programs that help them. Are they underfunded? Do they need more oversight and accountability? Yes. I have family members that have worked 30 years with the county in those programs, and day in and day out, they see the abuse and the waste that occurs. So again, this comes back to government never really does anything very well in a mass spectrum. So these problems that we're talking about, they do need to be dealt at a state level, and those priorities need to be set by the public. The voting population out there, they need to be coming forward to the state legislature to say, we need more priorities on child protective services. We need more priorities and money spent on education, whether it be before birth and or after birth. And you talk about children
We got to stop you because you've been going there. And let's pivot. Let's shift here. And Jerone, we'll start with you on this one. Who won the presidency in 2020?
Let's say it like this. Bernie Sanders should have been the DNC candidate in 2016. Bernie Sanders should have been the DNC candidate in 2020, because one of Bernie Sanders' attorneys took the DNC to court and got the DNC to confess that they did not have to respect the will of the people, and that they, in the back room, while they're smoking cigars, this is in the statement, that they can choose and select who they want to be the candidate for the DNC. Now, my question is, why wouldn't they do the same thing to the RNC? Why wouldn't they do that to us? I believe that there were some whole lot of things that have taken place, and all they had to do, it didn't have to be fraud on a massive scale. All it had to be is in six swing states, all right? Pennsylvania, Wisconsin, Michigan, Georgia, Arizona, and Nevada.
Who won the presidency in 2020?
I believe President Donald Trump won it.
You believe President Trump won it?
I do believe
he
won.
Backroom deal. Nothing has been proven. Nothing has made it to court because the evidence just simply isn't there. Why do you believe that?
The evidence is there. So we have a
judge. Why did the courts not believe the evidence is
there? Well, the courts was never allowed them to admit evidence in the court. We have judges in Pennsylvania who have said that 200,000 ballots were illegal and that they should not have been admitted because they broke the law in submitting those ballots.
Last question on this. Why would a court not accept evidence of that?
Well, I have no idea why they would not accept it.
The Attorney General doesn't bring it in.
So who won in 2020?
Technically, according to the ballots, Biden won. But if you discount and take away all of the fraudulent ballots that we're in, like the 30,000 that our audit provided here, if you take them out, then President Trump would have won here, and I would have won as well.
But the Arizona audit, the one done
Arizona audit,
commissioned by
what
the
they're
state
doing
senate.
Is, we know they're wrong. We know we've got over 30,000 ballots that are wrong. Well, why is the Attorney General sitting around here doing nothing? He ought to be taken to be to withdraw our.
Do you
wait
think
a minute. I thought that the audit found actually more votes for Biden and somewhat fewer for Trump. I mean, the audit confirmed, maybe on a little on the high side, what the official results were.
That's right. If I count all the ballots again, I get the same results off by about 100. That's not the problem. When you got 30,000 invalid ballots in there, you got to get them out.
Why do you think the Attorney General, the chief law enforcement officer of the state, has not arrested anyone, not indicted anyone over what you see as glaring evidence?
He's not doing his job. What else can they say?
Is it nothing more than that he's not doing his job?
Well, I don't know why he doesn't. You have to ask him why that is.
Can I just say one thing? We had an admission by the president, Joe Biden. We caught it on videotape. He said that we have put together the greatest fraud team in American history. He said that. Now, y'all have seen the videotape? Y'all haven't seen it. I can tell by the way you're looking at it.
We have not seen that.
Oh, the video is there.
He used the word fraud.
He said it word for word.
Okay.
That we have put together this fraud team. Now, that video needs to be played.
Rene, who won the election in 2020, the presidential election in Arizona and in around the country?
So I'm going to answer it this way. The election was certified by all the states, and it was certified by the legislation that President Biden is our president. Now, are there shenanigans going on all around the country? Probably. So this is nothing new. There have been fraudulent and loss of trust by the American people in our electoral college and in the election process since Bush Gore. When you go back that far, people were throwing out election fraud claims back then. And it's only been a sliding scale worse. So this is nothing new. We still have a lot of people out there that can report on fraud that they've seen at the polling places, a lot of the mail-in ballots, the harvesting that is illegal in Arizona. So a lot of the shenanigans, but again, it's nothing new. But what we need to do to move forward and get past this is for the state legislation across all states to start reinstituting, to reinforce auditability, security, and trust to back to the electorate because they don't trust it.
Maricopa County had numerous audits. The state Senate ran what it described as an audit. Nothing was found. If nothing is found,
that's
what
not
does
100%
that say?
Correct.
This, yes.
Nothing, there were
no
things
widespread,
found.
No widespread fraud was found.
So this is, again, data. Widespread. Those are parsing words. Look, I don't want to rehash 2020. Like I said, President Biden is our president. And my son in a couple years is going to be swearing oath to that president if he wins re-election, whoever it may be, because he's about to be a commissioned officer. But what we need to do is ensure we restore the trust of the American people into our election processes. And that only happens if state legislatures step up.
Do you think the voters, Republican voters in CD4, want to hear that message, the message that we're hearing, that there was widespread fraud, that there was all sorts of shenanigans going on, and that we need to tighten things up? Is that what the voters want to hear? Do they want to?
I think the voters want to have it fixed. They want to have all possible ways of fraud eliminated,
right?
Like such as one like no more mail-in ballots unless you're almost dead in the hospital or serving in the military in a foreign country. We all can make it there. So get rid of the mail-in ballots. That's a lot of potential.
Get rid of early voting.
Get rid of the early voting.
That's what Republicans in this district want.
I believe them. If you're going to do early voting, get rid of early voting. Show up at the polls in person.
Okay.
Because that gets us one piece of fraud that can be out of there. Another one is, clean up the dead people rolls. Get our voting rolls cleaned up. That's what the counties, Maricopa County needs to be doing. You clean up the voting rolls, you get rid of the dead people, you get us to vote. We've been voting in person for 200 years. We can do it again.
Should we get rid of early voting?
In some cases. I believe that in cases of health risk and health issues for the elderly.
Soldiers overseas,
For soldiers overseas, of course, we need that. But as far as early voting and just mail-in ballots, I think that's open to and susceptible to cheating.
Is that something you think Republican voters in this district want to
hear? Oh, absolutely.
You think they want that?
I've been at every integrity rally we've had in this state. I've been at just about every rally, okay? And these are the things that keep coming up. They want to get rid of early voting. They want to get rid of the paper ballots. They want to get rid of the machines and go back to the paper ballots. They want honest and true elections.
Rene, do the voters in your district want to get rid of early voting?
No, not that I've heard. So, as I said before, this is in the top 3-4 items that our constituents are concerned about. They're concerned about the economy. They're concerned of, teachers taking over their kids and trying to indoctrinate them. They're concerned about grocery bills. Okay, this gets talked about, and I can appreciate candidate Jerone Davison going to rallies that are intended to talk about corruption in the vote, and that's what they talk about. It kind of makes sense. But when I'm door knocking, it gets brought up just as to, are we going to be insured by the state legislature that we have a fair, open and transparent election? They're not trying to rehash the old election. They're trying to make sure that our next election can be audited. Now, all the other stuff, again, that's at a state level. Every state needs to be dealing with this in their own way. They know their communities better than Washington, D.C. was. And I want to close it out saying I am opposed vehemently to H.R. 1 going through, because this is a state issue. The local people need to pick how they want to vote, whether it be early vote, whether, again, because of the different environments across the United States.
Okay.
It's not for us to decide. It's for the states to decide.
Okay. Well, let's, since you've all mentioned education, expand a little more on that, on what the role of the federal government would be concerning what happens in the classroom. What, if any, is the role of the federal government on what goes on in a classroom when your kids are sitting in there? You want to start?
The federal government doesn't have any really say in it. Here we are back to the Constitution again. It's not in the Constitution. The federal government shouldn't be talking about it at all. That reverts to the states, 10th Amendment, to the people, or the states. We don't let the states decide what goes in there. Personally, I don't want this CRC stuff going to our kids. I don't want them brainwashed. I don't want them talking about all this junk. Read, writing, arithmetic, throw some music in there and some football in there. That's where they need to be doing. And they're doing poor on scores. We need to get the scores up competent. These are the future of our people, and we need to make sure they're competent to take on when we leave.
Rene?
So I agree with Ken and Giles in principle, in that the federal government does not need to be involved in education. Again, I'm going to sound like a broken record. So we have school districts for and superintendents at the states. The federal government doesn't need to be involved in educating our kids. Okay, the parents, in coordination with the teachers in the school districts, they need to be setting curriculum and they need to be transparent. There's good schools out there. My parents are a product of the Channel Unified School District. Phenomenal schools. We stayed in our public schools the entire time because we loved them. They have one of the best graduation rates. They don't get any special treatment from the superintendent of schools. And they were able to make it happen because they had great leadership and they had a great board. Mm-hmm. That's where the parents need to go, and they have been, and they've been vilified for it from the federal government. And they've been vilified because they're trying to protect their children.
And Jerome?
Absolutely. The federal government should not have any hands on the education system in the states. The states should handle that. The parents should have more rights and say in the curriculum for their children. I believe that vilifying the parents is by the government, by the AD, was a terrible move, and it has really motivated the parents to get even more involved in their children's education. I believe that they should stop talking about sexualization when it comes to the children and allow the parents to do and say at whatever time they want to introduce this conversation to their children. But the Fed should stay out of the educational system.
So you believe that, but you don't want the Congress to have that responsibility?
No.
Okay. Dave, we'll start with you. The border wall, I believe that you would like to see that completed.
Absolutely.
Why do you think, as you reach for something there, why do you think the wall has not been completed so far?
Mm-hmm. Because they don't want it completed. That was down on the border. This is the piece of the border wall laying on the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, people can just walk across anytime they want. And we did get into the COVID, they can come across without masks. But, the border is our country. We need to keep it secure to stop the drugs coming into our country, killing the people, the human trafficking coming into it, the illegal immigrants. That's one of the laws we need to change. Is just because you step a foot on the United States doesn't mean you automatically get all of these benefits. We need to stop that 14th Amendment where it says they're all entitled to all the welfare and education. It's taxing us. We cannot afford to educate and take care of the entire world.
For those who say that a border wall is expensive, it's ineffective, it hurts the environment, it simply doesn't work.
Tell that to North Korea and South Korea. See how well the border wall works there. Try the Berlin Wall. How well did that work when you had a wall? Look around Pelosi's house if you want to see how well the border wall works. I mean, it works. It is effective. You come in through the ports that are aligned at the ports of entry.
Okay, we got you.
Do it the legal way. I mean, I have several friends that have become American citizens by choice, and they paid the time to do it.
Jerone, the border wall is not completed. Why do you think it has not been completed? President Trump pledged that it would be, and he pledged that Mexico would pay for it. Neither has happened. It's still not built. Is it an effect? Is it the right thing to do?
It is the right thing to do. We see that once Biden came in, the same week that he came into office, He stopped the construction of the wall. As a matter of fact, he paid the contractors not to finish completing the wall. And it was working, and it's necessary because I believe that it's also a humanitarian effort as well. We have people coming into this country. If you have the opportunity to come into America, wouldn't you take the chance? Wouldn't you take that trip? We have women are being raped, children are being killed on these convoys into America. It's very dangerous. They're trafficking drugs in here. And the wall works. And President Donald Trump, I believe he did create a way for Mexico to pay for it. He created a treaty between Canada and Mexico, and that was producing, buying our produce from our farmers. It was up to billions of dollars. And so that was enough to pay for the wall.
Rene, why isn't the wall built? And do you think that a wall, a physical wall, is the best way to address immigration concerns, border security concerns?
So I think you're graying over two different issues regarding border security and immigration. We need to distinguish the two. The border wall helps prevent the trafficking, as I mentioned before, trafficking of drugs, trafficking of weapons and cash back. And again, the massive amount of human trafficking that's going on. Again, I see this on the front lines every day in our nonprofit. These women are sex trafficked across the border, and then they come in to be human trafficked for a few days, and they realize that they can make 10 times as much, 100 times as much off of them if they're sex trafficked. And all an open border does is grow the vulnerable population within our country that are susceptible to these predators. So that needs to be addressed. And in my opinion, at the federal government level, what they've done is they've hamstringed the Border Patrol and ICE and any other law enforcement entity that wants to enforce the border rules and laws and regulations, but they're being told not to. And they get vilified by the federal government by some, again, and we've seen already before in Texas, and they get vilified for trying to do their job.
Okay, okay. Dave, you want to get on this?
Well, the state can take over as well. It's an invasion. Here we go on here. Let the states start taking it. Texas is starting to take it up. We need to, secure our borders because, the border security is stopping the illegal stuff from crossing the border. You got to go through the port. But, like you were saying, immigration is another issue, and we need to stop it. So, because the bait that's coming, all I have to do is step one foot under the U.S. soil, and I'm automatically in.
Well, that
got to stop some of that. That law's got to change.
There are nuances, and I do appreciate in Arizona saying that we need to build it if the feds won't. We don't own that land. A lot of that's federal land. A lot of that's other Indian land that we have no regulations over. Difference in Texas is that many of the area that was uncompleted was state land. Mm-hmm. So, there's nuances there that we also need to be wary of because we want to make sure that we're not overstepping our bounds.
Are there nuances in controlling border security with high-tech devices, with things other than a physical wall?
So, look,
there is.
We can do it all. Just like with energy and just like with any other thing when you talk law enforcement, businesses and finance, you need a diverse way of dealing with any issue. You need to look at how things are working. You can't tell me walls don't work because California wound up filling up their wall that ends in the Yuma sector. But yet Yuma sector seems to have the most amount of crossings. They stopped crossing where the wall was in San Diego and in Chula Vista area, and they come now to Arizona. Interesting how that occurs. So a wall provides a barrier. Now, is it the end all be all? No. You need technology, but you need a will of the federal government to enforce the laws to begin with, which we're missing.
On the immigration front, I'd like to get your opinions on how you feel about the DREAM Act, allowing children who were brought, people who were brought here as children growing up in the U.S. being allowed citizenship.
Me first?
Go for it.
There are seven things you got to do to become a United States citizen. Okay, one of the things I would want to propose to change is the background check. Being a federal firearms dealer, I can call up ATF and do a background check on any one of us here or anyone that wants to purchase a gun and have an answer probably within 5 minutes. However, when you got a dreamer coming in, they came in with their parents when they're 7 years old from some unknown place that they really don't ever been at. And immigration is looking at them saying, where'd you come from? And they said, I guess something. So they contact the police that are in that area. What do you got on them? You got any felonies on them? You got any convictions on them? And the police come back and say, we don't have anything. They must be hiding something. Please check again. And this takes several years.
This is for a seven-year-old?
For a seven that came over at 7 years old, and now they're 20 years old, 30 years old. Mm. Most of the dreamers are well past 30. And that brings up another problem, is that they wanted to be citizens. They should have had their citizenship papers submitted by now, and they'd already be citizens. But in order to speed up that citizen papers, we need to get rid of some of this background check. You got to take the test. There's 100 questions out there. You're going to get a test of 10. All of the answers there. You can figure this stuff out by going right down through the immigration, telling you exactly what you need to do.
Is that,
swear allegiance to
is
America.
Is that a yes or no on the DREAM Act?
I would say no.
Okay.
Jerome?
Well, I would say yes and no. It's a kind of perplexed kind of situation.
Say, yeah.
You have people that are coming into this country. Their parents brought them here, and they're here. They've been raised here. They've contributed to society. They're working. They're doing what they got to do. But I believe that there should be a process. We should make a immigration process that says to the Dreamers that you need to complete your citizenship by such and such time. They have a chance to be assimilated into our country and become citizens in a time frame, and then we give them a chance.
Accelerated time frame?
Accelerated time. I believe that we need to have more immigration judges. We need to get more serious about our immigration process. That way we don't have people coming in, opening up this border, and rushing the border. We need to have them come through our assimilation process so that we can know who they are and not have them coming through the border.
Does that make sense to you, Rene?
So when it comes to the DREAM Act, I have the same sense of all of immigration policy when we talk about visas and everything else. I'm willing to have that discussion once the border is closed and secured.
Yes, absolutely.
Because until then, we've already been hoodwinked many times when we start down these discussions, even during the Trump administration, starting with the Reagan administration, when we got hoodwinked that we were secure, bordered, and then they gave amnesty, and then they opened up the border back. So we need to do that first. And then I'll start discussions with around any other immigration policy. Yes, we are a nation of immigrants, and I'm fully behind growing our population through immigration. However, I will not have that discussion until the border
What would constitute
secure.
A closed and secure border?
That we now can control all ports of entry so that we don't have people sneaking in through, again, the gaps in the wall, and we've addressed a lot of the tunneling. You know, again, I'm from the southern Arizona area, Nogales and Douglas, and we know all the tunnels that are down there. But yet again, the lack of the will of the federal government to allow Border Patrol to do their job and use technology. And we talked about the dollar value. We lost more in COVID fraud than it would have taken to finish building the wall.
Hands down.
I'm just trying to figure out what border a closed and secure border would look like.
Yeah, so that all immigration is done through ports of entry. All transfers across the southern border, just like up on the northern border in Canada, all transfers across the border are done through ports of entry. I don't think that's too much to ask.
And the big time frame that you talk about, how it takes so long, is because of this background check. Because any one of these people that want to become, any one of the Dreamers that want to become citizens can pass that test in a day.
But do you believe that the border should be resolved first before any kind of consideration would be made for the DREAM Act?
Well, that's a yes and no kind of thing. I think if you make it a yes, it's going to push the Dreamers to get the job done. Look up those seven things on the immigrations, customs and immigrations, and see what they are. They can, and all the test questions, you know, these things they can do. Like one of the test questions, like who's the president? They can pass this, they can have it. The Dreamer can get it done in a day. It's the background check that's holding us up. And if we can speed up that background check by telling the background, the people that are doing the back, stop checking down in South Africa somewhere where they've never been because the police down there have no record of these people ever being there, and stop claiming that they must be hiding something. Use ATF, like a firearm, put it to use. Call them up, put the data in there, and get a yes or no on it immediately. That's your background check.
I can tell you what it also looks like, is that when you have Title 42, which is getting ready to end, I think, in a couple of weeks, is that this is going to create an extra flood of an invasion into the country. I believe what we need to do is go back to the Remain in Mexico policy, and also we've got to discover and find out how is it 100,000 or 50,000 or 20,000 people are forming in the lower parts of Mexico. How are they forming? Who is paying for them to do this? We need to get to the bottom of who is funding this and how it's starting so that we can cut that out. And so we can stop having an invasion at the border. That's what a closed border would look like, to where they can no longer come through these gaps, come over water and come into the country. And once they get the foot on the country, now they become our issue. Now we have to pay for their health care. Now we have to pay for them, their birth. Now we have to pay for their housing. It's a real burden on the American people.
The last question on this, do you, and Rene, we'll start with you. Should businesses that hire undocumented immigrants, should they be more strictly penalized? Should they be, should there be more responsibility on that end?
So I'll try to give you a short answer, so yes. But again, this immigration debate that we're having right now, it's not on the forefront minds of the people that are in our district. We very rarely, hardly touched on the financials of housing and the inflation that's going on in this country. That's the number one reason people are, issue that people are having in our district. Water is growing. I mean, we live in Arizona. We're coming into a water crisis. And we didn't get asked at all about water. I mean, that's the major economic driver and growth that we need in Arizona, and we didn't touch on that. Those are the issues that our people are dealing with in our district. You know, immigration, yes, they want some security, but that comes to also a law and order discussion, because people aren't going to want to move their businesses into South Arizona if they're being overrun by illegal crossings and traffickers. People aren't going to want to open a business in any city when they're going to get rioted up and totally destroyed.
Okay, real quickly, Jerone, should businesses be further penalized if they hire undocumented immigrants?
Well, we got to get back to, this is what I want America to get back to doing. We've got to get back to obeying the law. I mean, there are reasons why you want to give people jobs, you want to help people, you want to be compassionate, but a nation without laws is not a nation. So I believe that there should be stricter penalties.
What do you think, Dave?
Yeah, more penalties, because you can't, you know, encourage people to break the law. And if you give them jobs up here, you're encouraging the more people to come out and break the law. I don't mind. I think the people want to make money. They want to work. They're honest, good, hardworking people, and they want to make money, but they're breaking the law. And you can't allow them to break one law to break another law and say it's okay. E-Verify should be working. And I don't know about how much of a penalty it would be, but okay. I don't want to have our businesses suffer because of this, but we want the business. But just tell them that, you know, I don't know what to tell them. It's a discussion.
I don't want to let this end without, let's talk about housing and housing costs, the homelessness problems that we have, the costs of, the rising costs of finding shelter. Rene, you raised it. What would you do in Congress to address those things?
The way we address it in Congress, again, is by reducing the inflation that we're having at a federal level. And that's all we should be involved in.
And how do we do that?
So by actually balancing the budget, by stop printing money, by letting businesses, reducing regulation, and letting businesses run their own business. The federal government does not need to be involved in that. The reduction of regulation will save them billions a year easily. And when you come to housing, I mean, that is a localized issue, okay? It is not the job of the federal government. And for that, I mean, on the city council, we deal with this on almost a daily basis. It is not for us to decide how much your house is worth or how much you're to pay for rent. When I sold my house, I did not want the city or federal government to come in and say, you can't sell your house for that much because it's too expensive. It's not our role. What happens is that we have a society here, and we've developed our state and a lot of other cities that people want to be here. So what's going to happen? If people want to come here and we have growing businesses with a major industry, you know, such as Intel, such as TSMC, Northrop Grumman down in Chandler, they've also been growing. When they want to be in a city or in a state, it's going to wind up driving up prices. But what we do see is also a raising wage that goes with it. But with the inflation the federal government can influence, we could hopefully simply curb some of that so that people can get back to work and live reasonably.
Quickly, Jerone.
Yeah, we can also stop foreign investors from buying so much property. This is also raising the cost of property. We have so many investors coming from overseas and they're buying a property. We can also put a limit on that in our state. Also, by closing the border, I see it. I knock on doors, people are complaining about the rent, and they're talking about the government subsidizing housing for people that are crossing the border. That is making the landlords make the rent go up, because now they see they can charge, instead of $1,500, they can charge $2,000 and the government's gonna pay for it. So now they're evicting the citizens of America. And now they're bringing in the illegals, and the government is subsidizing for their rent. So these are some things that we can deal with.
Okay. Economics. Bringing economics to Arizona. You're talking about housing. Just get government out of the way. And it saddens me that we can send $32 billion to protect somebody else's border, but we can't protect our own. We can't protect our own veterans. My father died at the hands of the VA because of the incompetence that was there. Not the doctors. The doctors, the nurses, and the staff are great. It's the policies that the VA needs to take. They don't. It's Veterans Administration. It's not Veterans Medical. But that's just one example. Take care of everybody. What about the homeless that are sitting around here? We could get in, you know, give them some, build some housing, help the people build the housing, give them some, do whatever you can to help the people that are here. Timothy says, take care of our own before we take care of somebody else. That's
okay.
Where I'm at.
Economics. Okay, we've got a little more than about a minute and a half, something like that left. Rene, we'll start with you. A lot of agreement here on this set. Not surprising, you're all the same party. Why should voters, Republican voters, choose you and not these other two gentlemen? And quickly, please.
Well, I've got it wrong. It's kind of my closing statement here, but I've served as an elected official. You know, I understand the nuances of having to deal with these issues in a grander scale.
Okay. Jerone, again, and you, not them. Why?
Well, because Congress isn't short of a lot of businessmen and attorneys and politicians. Congress and America is short of bold, strong, God-fearing people in government, and that's what we need in this hour.
Okay, and again, we are getting to closing statements, but I'm trying to get some differentiation. Why you and not these two gentlemen?
Because I'm technically competent. I have a Bachelor of Science degree in electrical engineering. I'm a commercial jet pilot. That takes care of, you know, okay. So what? But I'm technically competent. Second thing, I'm a businessman. I have an MBA. I have my own business. I work for the largest oil company in the world. And thirdly, I'm a man of my word.
And I'm a man of my word, and we got to stop right now because we have time constraints. It's time now for closing statements. And going in reverse order of our opening remarks, we start with Rene Lopez.
Thank you, Ted. Thank you, Mary Jo. Thank you, Arizona PBS and Arizona State University for hosting this. So, you know, the one thing that differentiates, as we're talking about, the one thing that differentiates us is the candidates here and the other two, they have never had to cast a vote and be held accountable for that vote to their constituents. I've got a proven track record of fighting for businesses and backing the police and fire and making sure that we push back against the state and the federal government so that, again, people can run their businesses and run their lives. Too many times, again, we send politicians to Congress and they lose sight of the purpose and why they're there. And what I want to do is represent you in Congress to make sure that you are able to live your lives and raise your kids without the federal government getting involved.
And now the closing statement from Jerone Davison.
Hello, Arizona. You've heard our message. You've seen us on stage here. Congress, America, we are tired of politicians coming in and promising us what they are going to do, like Mr. Lopez here. He knows the law. He has experience in these things. But we've had enough of that. It's time now to send in people who are everyday Americans like you, yourself and I. I should go in and represent you because I'm your everyday person. I've been with you for the birth of your children, been there for their first days of school, been there for their graduations, been at ball games, and I hear your issues daily. And unlike most of our opponents, I've been there daily throughout most of your life as your pastor for close to 30 years. I would love to have your vote. I would love to have your support. I know times are hard now, but I would like for you to go to my website and make a donation at JeroneForCongress.com.
All right, thank you. And now we turn to Dave Giles.
Thank you, Arizona. I want to be able to go to D.C. as a legislator to represent you, get our economy back on track. The price of gasoline is out of range. Food is out of range. Everything is costing more because the current administration has hampered us here in Arizona, you. We got to undo what's been done in this last administration. And to do that, we got to get with like-minded people, other congressmen, other congresswomen in D.C. Make laws, make bills, make legislation. I promise to create legislation that will back out the Patriot Act and get our political prisoners out of prison. I promise to hold legislation and comments. I'm getting mine.
Y'all done?
I promise to serve you people and to give you an idea how you can contact me. My personal cell phone number is 602-228-1388. Call me anytime you want to talk.
All right, very good. Gentlemen, thank you all very much. And thank you for joining us. Our next debate will be Wednesday when we hear from the Republican candidates running for Arizona Attorney General. That's at 5 and 10 p.m. Wednesday right here on Arizona Horizon and also streamed live at azpbs.org.
And you can watch this debate again on azpbs.org, where you can catch all past Arizona Horizon shows as well and follow coverage of this race and others at the Arizona Republic and on azcentral.com.
And that is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.
Thank you.
Holy smokes, we landed the...
Coming up tonight on Arizona PBS at 7, at 8, at 9, tonight starting at 7 only on Arizona PBS.